Mortality rates for nearly all types of cancer have decreased over the last 25 years, but pancreatic cancer is one of the few exceptions. The rare but deadly disease is projected to become the second leading cause of cancer-related death in the U.S. by 2030, and in recent years it has claimed the lives of several high-profile figures. Today you'll hear from a gastroenterologist, a surgical oncologist, and a radiation oncologist, all working together to reverse the trajectory. Doctors Nisa Kabilian, Patricio Polanco, and Todd Aguilera, thank you for being here. Dr. Kabilian, what is pancreatic cancer and how does it differ from other cancers that are maybe a bit more well known?
The pancreas is a gland located deep in the abdomen between the stomach and the spine, and it makes enzymes that help digestion and hormones that control blood sugar levels. A malignant tumor in the pancreas is called a cancer, and these cells grow out of control and can spread to other tissues and other organs. This year, we anticipate more than 62,000 Americans will be diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. Unfortunately, pancreatic cancer typically comes to presentation very late in the process. Diagnosis typically occurs via cross-sectional imaging in the way of CT scan and MRI. And we have the ability now to formally diagnose, to biopsy the pancreas with interventional tools such as endoscopic ultrasound.
Dr. Polanco, we've seen rates of survival improve in lung cancer and colorectal cancer, but not seen that same improvement in pancreatic cancer. Why is that?
Pancreatic cancer is currently the third leading cause of death for cancer in the United States, but it's estimated that by 2030, this will be the second cause. However, this is not because the death rates or overall survival is getting worse. The five-year survival for the first time has achieved double digits, 10%, according to the American Cancer Society. The main explanation is that the incidence of cancer remains relatively stable and the death rates of the other leading tumors has improved. Unfortunately, for pancreatic cancer, which is an aggressive tumor, we have not yet seen the major treatment breakthroughs at the pace that we would like to improve long-term survival.
Dr. Aguilera, how does radiation oncology and treatments with those therapies fit into the treatment equation?
One of the first most important questions that we ask is, has the tumor spread from the pancreas and can it come out surgically? In that situation, radiation may play a role, particularly if there's blood vessels involved that make the surgery very challenging to perform. In cases when patients are not resectable, the main treatment is really chemotherapy. And therefore, if patients do well with chemotherapy and they still don't have metastatic disease, it may be that patients can benefit greatly by consolidating that chemotherapy treatment with radiation in order to prevent this tumor from becoming further destructive.
Dr. Kabilian, you lead our program in interventional endoscopy. How does your work play a role in the treatment team in caring for pancreatic cancer patients?
There are really a number of interventional tools we can use to manage patients with pancreas cancer and also those at increased risk of developing pancreas cancer. One particular tool we frequently utilize is endoscopic ultrasound. So in this procedure, a specialized, very thin camera with an ultrasound probe at the very tip is advanced through the mouth into the intestine. This gets us very close to the pancreas and gets us really great images, and we can do a very detailed inspection of the pancreas. Our interventional tools are also used to treat pain caused by pancreas cancer. We know that pancreatic tumors tend to infiltrate the nerves around the pancreas. We now are able to inject medications directly into the nerves around the pancreas to improve quality of life. We currently can't treat pancreas cancer using our endoscopic tools. We certainly have many modalities to improve quality of life and improve pain management.
At UT Southwestern, we have a high-risk identification program for patients at risk for pancreatic cancer. Tell us how that program got started and how it's affecting the care of your patients.
Because we have no cure in 2022 for pancreas cancer, preventing this deadly disease before it ever occurs is really very critical. So typically, patients are deemed to be high risk for one of two reasons. Either they have a genetic predisposition to pancreas cancer, or they have a precancerous lesion. We monitor these individuals extremely closely and in patients with worrisome findings. So those that we are concerned are evolving to a pancreas cancer. We collaborate with our surgical colleagues and we make recommendations to potentially remove the high risk diseased areas of the pancreas in order to prevent cancer from ever developing.
Dr. Polanco, what are the genetic risk factors for pancreatic cancer?
10 to 15% of the patients with pancreatic cancer has some related genetic cause. In general, we can divide those in two broad categories. On one end, we have the genetic syndromes associated to pancreatic cancer. And those patients with familial pancreatic cancer is the second category, which is defined as a family with a pair of affected first-degree relatives. This could be parent and child or sibling pair. Thankfully, the guidelines now allow us to send these patients an insurance cover, the testing done to rule out these genetic syndromes that may condition pancreatic cancer at a later time.
Dr. Aguilera, you hear the term molecular engineering in terms of developing new cancer treatments. Tell us about the work that's going on at UT Southwestern in that area.
Pancreatic cancer is one of those diseases where these new immunotherapies of the last decade really have not made a significant impact. So my group's been thinking about this a lot from different molecular engineering approaches, and this is really what kind of inspires. We hope that years down the road, we'll continue to be able to make further advancements, and I think this is a disease where we can do that.
Dr. Kabilian, over the last 5 or 10 years, many celebrities have had pancreatic cancer. How has the news coverage around their disease and their treatments raised awareness?
The increased notoriety with the increased public awareness, it's really led to many positive changes, including increases in funding for scientific research, expansion of clinical trial opportunities, and perhaps most importantly, individuals now becoming proactive and aware in considering their own risk and having those important conversations with their physicians about how to mitigate those risks.
Dr. Polanco, we know that surgery for pancreatic cancer is one of the more difficult surgeries in medicine. Tell us about the progress that you're making in the operating room.
Very important innovation in the surgical treatment of pancreatic cancer is the use of minimally invasive techniques. Our institution has adopted robotic surgery as the standard approach for pancreatic cancer. In fact, we have become one of the leading institutions in this field, and we're not only currently training our own trainees, but also surgeons from US and abroad on this approach. We can obtain the same oncologic outcomes that a conventional open surgery, but with lesser amount of pain, less blood loss, and a prompter recovery from the operation. This would improve the chances of the patient getting to the next phase of treatment, whether that is chemo or radiation or else.
Dr. Aguilera, if you were to look 10 years from now in treating pancreatic cancer patients, particularly in radiation oncology, what do you think we'll be doing differently 10 years from now for what we're doing today?
Pancreatic cancer is a very heterogeneous disease and does not behave the same for every patient. And therefore, once we get more sophisticated with our scientific tools to understand the disease course for a particular patient, so much of the decision-making has to be personalized based upon that patient's tumor. And that might be dependent upon the biology of that tumor or how the tumor is behaving. So I think there's really an opportunity in the coming years for us to be rethinking how we are doing our clinical trials so that we don't end up killing therapies that work for some patients but don't work for others.
Thank you all for joining me today and for this important information about the progress being made in pancreatic cancer.
Thank you for having us, Dr. Warner.
It's such a pleasure. Thank you for having us.
Thank you for the opportunity to share these questions.
Thank you for joining us. Until next episode, stay safe and stay healthy.